Hi, everybody. It's Gene Simmons, and you're not, and you're listening to the Potter Than Hell podcast with Steve, BC, BB, and Dylan. But you knew that, didn't you?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Potter Than Hell podcast. This is your last stop on the crazy train of hard rock and heavy metal. So sit back, buckle in, and hang on. Here we go.
Hello there, Potter Than Hellions. Welcome back to the Potter Than Hell podcast. This is Steve, your host, and I am joined as always by
BC
and the triumphant return of BB.
Yes!
Oh, that was a lame effect. That was not good.
Come on.
Oh, God. That sounds like when they get something wrong on The Price is Right. All right, well, BB, anyways,
hey,
welcome back.
Do you want
back.
Me to do this one?
That's even better.
Do you want me to start over?
It doesn't matter. Did you not like that in there?
No, I like it. Well, I thought you might put it at the end. All right. And our keyboard player with the lame sound effects is Dylan. What's up?
Dylan.
I'm all fucked up here. See? Oh, that threw me off. And we have our special returning guest host from the Growin Up Rock podcast, Mr. Stephen Michael. How are you, my friend?
Dude, I'm awesome. And let me just say, I'm going to approach this episode with some fine lyrics for you. I'll leave you with these fine words. Such a wicked woman, black magic, voodoo queen, lesbo, nympho, maniac. Ooh, she's got a girlfriend that's 17. What's up, fellas?
Not much. Now, you're leaving us with those words. Does that mean you're going already?
All right. Well, thanks for talking to us.
Yeah, it was fun. I'll see you in Vegas in a couple days.
Turn into it.
Good start, good lyrics, and I think we're going to be hearing it from that song once again later on in the episode. So, Stephen, how's things going over at Growin Up Rock Land?
Growin Up Rock Land is moving right along. Everything is fantastic. I just finished up a short interview with Eric Martinson from Eclipse discussing the new release of the latest album, Paradigm.
Cool.
And, yeah, it's all good.
All right, I like the new songs that they have released already. I've been checking those out, and I've been I think they have three or four out already, and I'm really liking it. I like those guys; they're really good. And you had pretty much almost the whole band there when you interviewed those guys last time, right?
Yeah, we did have most of the band last year. I think it was last year.
And Steven, Magnus.
Magnus, not Mangus.
Not Mangus, Mangus. You got me saying it now. Magnus. All right. Thanks for joining us tonight, Stephen. It's always fun having you here. And BB, welcome back, my friend. How the hell are you?
Whew! Man, that was a long vacation.
It was.
Boy, oh boy. I used up all my vacation time for the podcast, and it's great to be back here. My brother is talking about shit that we've been listening to forever, so...
He's got this disgusting W.A.S.P. shirt on. It's terrible.
Terrible.
Yeah. And, you know, BB really was not on vacation. He was suspended because he broke the our rules. He was caught with a performance-enhancing drug. He was using Viagra, and he was not allowed to do that. So he was on the bench for a little while.
Yeah, no, thank God.
What have you learned?
I've learned my lesson because that fifth one I took that night, it got caught in my throat. I had, like, that stiff neck, so... it's all good.
See? All right. You feel better now? You got the neck brace off?
Neck brace is off. I'm ready to rock and roll.
Okay. Awesome. And before we get into it, we'll do what we usually do. We'll see what everybody's listening to. And BC, you know what? I don't think we ever really hardly ever. Holy fuck, I can't speak tonight. Hardly ever start with you. So what do you got going?
Just W.A.S.P. mainly this week. It's a little Tom Kiefer in there again, but mainly W.A.S.P. Nothing too exciting.
All right. Mr. Michael, how about you? What do you got going?
Listening to, obviously, a lot of W.A.S.P. to get ready for this episode. And, just listening to some new singles, new releases. And tried the Tom Kiefer, tried the new Darkness. Not real excited about either one of those, so I'll keep trying.
Okay. BB, how about you?
I pulled out of my hat the Mr. Big, Live from the Living Room. a nice little acoustic album that they released in 2012. Undertow on it, Take Cover, and of course they have to throw in there To Be With You, but a great, great acoustic.
They have a song called Camel Toe?
I thought I said Take Toe.
Undertow.
Get your mind on it, Agassi.
Oh boy,
it's that fucking shirt, man. It's the shirt. All right,
God.
Dylan, how about you? What do you got going?
After last week's episode, I've been listening to some Alice Cooper. I went from the beginning, and I made it actually to, I believe, Billion Dollar Babies was the one that I left off on, which is the album that one of the albums that we covered. So I listened to. I started with Love It to Death because I skipped the first two. But I went to Love It to Death. I listened to Killer. I listened to a couple of other ones that I can't think of right now. But a good catalog, good starting catalog for him.
Killer is really good. And, Steven, I was actually going to ask you if you wanted to participate in that episode, but I was listening to Growing Up Rock like a day before I was going to call you, and you said that you weren't a big fan of Alice Cooper. So I'm like, oh, well, I'll fucking scratch him off of that one. So I didn't ask you for that one, and I know you're not a big Alice guy, but Killer is an excellent album. And like I said on the episode, I think that – did that come out yet?
Yeah, it was last week's episode.
Okay.
Yeah, I respect Alice. I'm just not a huge fan of the music. I do like some of the stuff, but I think overall I'm meh on a lot of his music.
Okay, cool. My counterpart there from the Growin' Up Rock podcast, I also checked out the new Darkness album. I promised Peter Cessari from the I Love It Loudcast that I would check it out, and still not grabbing me. There's some cool parts in there. I can't do the yodeling voice. It just fucking drives me insane.
It's not even close to what yodeling is.
And, whatever.
You know what I'm trying to say.
But, like, I don't know. I if you listen to the lyrics, I've heard them being called clever. I think they try too hard in that. And for me, it just comes off as stupid. I'm sorry, Peter. I can't do it. I still hate the darkness. And
That's why he sleeps with the night.
Some of the music is really good.
I mean, I love the music.
But just the fucking, that just shit just drives me crazy. And there's one song, it's called Deck Chair. It's about a fucking chair.
Listen,
it's about a fucking chair.
So I'll represent Pete a little bit. Pete really loves the darkness.
I know, he does.
But let me just say this. So I do like the darkness. I'm a fan of the darkness, and I think you absolutely need to see the band live because they're amazing live. They're fun live. It's just a fun show live. However,
caveat.
This is a big however. This latest album. So I've only gone through it once, and it just wasn't sitting well with me, and I'm gonna keep trying. I'm gonna go through it another few times, but I like the last couple records. I thought they were really good, and I like them when they're just straight ahead rock and roll. I can get past his falsetto and all that other stuff when they just riff out some tunes, but when they start doing like this kind of slow and poppy and just I'm not into it, and that's the new record for me is just kind of a little boring and a little meh. It has a couple of tunes that I like on it, but we'll see where that goes.
Yeah, there were a couple riffs and stuff that I was like, okay, that's pretty cool, and then it loses me. And I actually checked out the new Angel album, which I was like kind of ambivalent to check that out, but it was actually I got about three quarters of it, and then it was time to go to bed because it was like 1:30 in the morning. But I enjoyed it. I thought it was pretty good. I enjoyed that. And your counterpart there said that when you guys did it. And by the way, you guys that episode you guys did on Spotify and streaming was absolutely fucking excellent. Very interesting with all the with your numbers, buddy. There, Sonny. Very cool episode. And I don't know how I forget what you said about Halloween, but he doesn't like them. I was listening to the new live album. I think it's awesome, and I don't know how the fuck you could be a fan of Iron Maiden and not like Halloween, but you know that's Sonny. He's crazy, and I've been listening to some classic Kiss. I've been spinning some vinyl, and I threw on some Molly Hatchet like the first couple albums a couple weeks ago, and really good, solid stuff. I never really gave those guys a big chance, and very good stuff, very cool. So you guys out there, you know, if you're a fan of The Darkness, check them out. They have a new album that's out. I think it's called Easter's Canceled, I think it's called.
Yeah.
New Angel album, that's called Risen. New Halloween Live from back in this Pumpkins United, I think it's called. Molly Hatchet. BC's got some W.A.S.P. and some Tom Kiefer going still. BB's listening to Mr. Big live from the living room.
From BC's living room.
Live from BC's living room.
Yeah, yeah.
Judy was there doing keg stands.
That's right.
She's out of control. She's out of control.
Terrible.
Steven's got some Tom Kiefer and some W.A.S.P. and he was giving the New Darkness a shot there. And The Darkness will be playing on Kiss Cruise 9 coming up in a couple weeks. And seeing The Darkness announced for the Kiss Cruise didn't help me wanting to book that cruise any more than I already didn't want to. And Dylan's scoping out some going in the back catalog of Alice Cooper. All right. As you guys see from the title, I'm not sure what Dylan's calling it yet, but we're talking about the band W.A.S.P. We Are Sexual Perverts, if you will. That was what people said that their name was. But I don't think they've ever said definitively what it is. I think it's just W.A.S.P. BB has the Fuck Like a Beast shirt on here.
Woo-hoo!
with the saw blade cod piece and on there. And he's
love it.
That's why he had to leave his sweat jacket on until we closed the building here, so he didn't want to offend anybody. But I mean, he doesn't give a fuck if he offends me. But,
that's right.
You know,
that's why I wore it.
That's how things.
I just want to let you know that I fuck like a beast. Yeah.
Well, when he was leaving the house, he put something over that shirt so that his better half didn't see it, and then he ran down the street where Steve picked him up.
She'd be pointing and laughing at me. Hey, that's why we have three kids, because I fucked for 5 seconds, right?
So then
I'm going to leave that one sitting right there on the table. All right, so what we're doing today is something kind of new we wanted to try. There's a lot of great bands out there, and W.A.S.P. is one of them that instantly came to mind when I thought of doing this. We want to dig deeper into the W.A.S.P. catalog. Everyone knows Blind in Texas and I Want to Be Somebody and Love Machine and everything like that. So what we wanted to do is we went through the catalog, myself, BB, BC, and Steven. Dylan is not going to participate in this episode. I'm sure he'll throw it. It'll be like I don't know, one of those sidekicks on one of those shows. I don't want to say
what
I mean.
One of those shows.
He's like the guy on the Arsenio Hall show, the guy from the side there that always says something.
I could be like the band leader. I could be like Paul Schaefer.
Yeah, there you go, Paul Schaefer. And Dylan has way more hair than Paul Schaefer, by the way. And
I'll ask, why not? Does Dylan just not like W.A.S.P.?
I'm not up on W.A.S.P. as everybody else, so I can't really do deep tracks for W.A.S.P. because I only really know the surface tracks, as it were.
He knows half of the greatest cuts one or whatever the hell it's called. The first cuts, first blood, last cuts. He knows about half of that. So, all right, let's jump into it. And what we'll do is we'll do three at a time. We'll go around and talk about them, and then we'll take a little break, do a jam, then we'll get our other three. Actually, on the back end of the show, we're going to do two deep cuts and then one of our more known tracks, I think, that everyone would know, one of our favorites from that. So we really have five deep cuts apiece. And so, Steven, first of all, before you go, let everybody know how you got into W.A.S.P. and, you know, your general thoughts on those guys and all that kind of shit. Go ahead, my friend.
I started with W.A.S.P. on the first record. I'd read some magazine articles and seen all the cool shit that they were doing. I think I picked up the Fuck Like a Beast picture disc that I had at one point in time. I wished I still had it, but I don't. And I was fortunate enough to see W.A.S.P. on the first tour, opening up for Iron Maiden on the Power Slave tour. Ended up backstage, met those dudes, took some great like front row pictures. And that's my story of getting into W.A.S.P. I love W.A.S.P.
Very cool. That must have been cool getting backstage with those guys. Did you get to meet those guys or just kind of see them in the area? Or?
I did meet them just briefly, and I just remember my recollection from that was that they were super fucking tall. Like, granted, I was only a probably 16-year-old kid at the time, but those guys were really, really tall. I remember all of them, Randy Piper, Blackie, Chris Holmes, And Tony Richards was with them at the time playing drums, and they were just super tall. That's what I remember.
That's cool. They didn't throw any raw meat at you, did they?
they did not. They just rock and rolled the crowd for, you know, 40 minutes opening up for the Maiden.
That's, hey, how'd they go over opening up for Maiden?
My recollection was pretty good. I mean, I was on the front row. I loved it. I knew what they were before they came on, so I was excited because I'd heard the first record and I loved the debut record. So,
very cool, very cool. Give us three of your deep cuts here. You were going to talk about, Stephen.
Well, all of mine are kind of deep cuts. I mean, I don't know. Does W.A.S.P. have any like popular songs except for maybe "Blind in Texas"? I really don't know.
I'd say like "Blind in Texas," "Inside the Electric Circus," "Love Machine," "I Want to Be Somebody." Pretty much the one, "Wild Child." Wild Child. Yeah, definitely "Wild Child." Definitely. I forgot about that one. I'd say pretty much stuff from the first like three albums, maybe, and maybe "The Real Me" from "Headless Children." But after that, like, there's albums like you don't hear. But I mean, as we go through here, there's some fucking amazing stuff that we're gonna talk about tonight.
Yeah, okay. Well, fair enough. I mean, I consider all of mine fairly deep tracks, but just getting back into this, the first song I'm going to talk about is "Ball Crusher" off of "The Last Command." I absolutely love that song. I'm not typically a lyric dude, but you heard me read some of the lyrics at the beginning of the thing, and the second verse, "Stole the rent and drank all my JD. She went and hijacked my brand new car. I say AC, she says DC. The damn bitch is just too bizarre." Come on, man. That's killer.
That's gold, baby. Gold, Jerry, gold.
Gold, man. Bye, 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 Ball Crusher, man. I love it. There's no hidden meaning about what this song is about. It's just cool, and I love the driving riff. So, "Ball Crusher" off "Last Command" is awesome. A deep track off of "The Headless Children," which I'm not a huge fan of this record, "The Headless Children." It had some stuff that I liked on it, but Rebel in the FDG is awesome. It kicks ass, man. From the opening when he screams, "I'm a rebel, baby," it kicks ass. I dig that tune. And then last in this series would be off the latest record, "Golgotha." I love the song "Shotgun." I think it's sort of a great sort of almost pop rock song for W.A.S.P. and just love the melody. I think it's an awesome tune. So "Shotgun" off "Golgotha." Those are my first three.
Good solid picks. What do you think about them, BB?
Yeah, great picks. "Ball Crusher." It's funny how we were going through this list, and I did Steven's last, just the way I just wrote them out and just the way I downloaded them. It's funny of listening to the newer stuff, and they get right back to the older stuff, and this right out of the game, like, boy, this older stuff is a lot slower than I remember it. But it was so much faster back then, but listening to the newer stuff today, and then listening to this one from The Last Command, it's like, wow, they've almost like got better with age. It's just a weird thing that
like
I picked up on my
wine.
Yeah. and Rebel in the FDG, it had hints to me of Wild Child. I don't know what it was. There's a little rhythm riff in there. It kind of had a little trigger of mine with Wild Child and Shotgun. Like Golgotha, they were out. Blackie was out of music for like 6 years when this came out. His fucking voice is so fucking good in this album, and it's just amazing what vocally he does on that album for, you know, taking that 6 year vacation. But great three picks to start off the show.
Agree. "Ball Crusher" off "The Last Command," great album. I mean, I like the album with the headless and the sticks in the back. It was on the back cover for the inside sleeve.
I think on the cover was a flag.
On the back, I'm talking about.
On like, the back.
It has owner, their heads on.
Oh, that was "The Last Command."
That's me. "Ball Crusher," "Last
Command." Oh, "Ball Crusher." Yeah, yeah. I'm sorry. I'm thinking of talking about fucking "Headless Children."
Listen here.
Yeah. "Last Command," that was. Their heads on the pikes.
Golgotha. I mean, to me, that's
That album was
good. Wow, that was an early.
That's a. You gotta get that right. You gotta get that right. That's just cranking album, man. And Headless Children. I love the Headless Children, especially Rebel and the FDG. Frankie Valli.
Frankie Valli, baby. Yeah, I'll tell you what. And I think there's two different Wasps.
Yep.
You have up to the first three albums, Wasp, Last Command, Inside the Electric Circus. That's what I think of as the fun party Wasp. And then once you get the Headless Children, they're like a fucking metal band after that. They're like, you know, talking about, you know, political shit and like all different kinds of stuff and like, you know, a lot of religion and shit thrown in there and like dark themes. But like the first three albums are fucking, they're the fun Wasp as far as I'm concerned. Ball Crusher, just a great fun song. The production, I think, on this album isn't as good as it. I don't like it as much as the first one. The solo's kind of lost in it, but really good song, and it's the first album with Steve Riley on drums. Just fucking great, great drummer. And, you know, we all know that he went on to be, you know, part owner, and now he's got his own version of LA Guns going out there. Rebel and the FDG from the Headless Children, fucking great song. It's got great background vocals. The drum sound for Frankie Benelli is fucking awesome. And it means Rebel and the FDG is fucking decadent generation. I love the... And this is a theme throughout, I think, a lot of the Wasp stuff is a lot of layered vocals on a lot of these songs. And this one, BC, here we go. BB, a little spoken word in this song.
A little bit.
Chris Holmes just fucking tears it up on this fucking album. He's an extremely underrated guitar player. And Shotgun, I like the little finger picking at the beginning. It's a really cool song. It's got a really crisp production to it. Good rocker from Golgotha. And Doug Blair plays lead guitar on this album. This guy fucking is amazing. This guy, you're going to hear me say Doug fucking Blair about 100 fucking times tonight. This guy just fucking kicks ass. And this is one song that instantly fucking caught me right off the bat when I first time I listened to Golgotha. This was one of the songs that was like, boom, this song is a standout on this album. I think they're great picks to start with. And BB, what do you got for us on the first round here?
All right. Let me see. Back, it was probably 85, 86. I got in the Wasp, the Last Command album. I was an album behind it. My buddy's brother had it. And Wild Child just blew me away when I first heard it, you know, opening track from the album. And it just sucks you right in from the beginning. So I was an album behind in 1985 with these guys, but Blackie Lawless, to me, high-end vocals, probably very underrated vocalist in my book. Spot-on, fantastic band. He's like Ozzy. He kind of just surrounds himself with good musicians, but these guys are like 12th-round draft picks that no, you know, that he just brings to the band and just makes fantastic.
And you know what, BB? There's a bearded Chris Holmes and an unbearded Chris Holmes. So just so you know.
I'm going to have to do a little research on which is bearded and which is unbearded.
Just throwing that. Unbearded is like the first couple albums, and then bearded and later on.
But there's definitely not a sober Chris Holmes.
No.
I don't think that's it. Those two words, that might be the first time that you were ever fucking using the same sentence.
All right, so I kind of pick my songs. Almost kind of, we already kind of touched on this. You know, the first three albums are, you know, home runs. Everybody had them. And it just seemed like Wasp kind of, you know, almost kind of fell off the edge of the earth. You know, they're releasing albums, but they never tour in the U.S. When they do a tour over here, they're canceling shows. And so I kind of pick all my songs from albums from 2000s and beyond. So my first pick was My Wicked Heart. Off the Dying for the World in 2002. The harmonies at the chorus of this, like Steve said before, like the background vocals with this is amazing. It almost has that Iron Maiden start to it. It's just a really, really cool song. And my second pick is from Unholy Tear from 2001, Locomotive Man. Longer song, I think it's like 6 minutes, but just the guitar work on this song. Chris Holmes is really, really good on this. And it's just another aspect of showing how great Blackie Lawless's vocals are. Just really, really good. And then my third pick is Tear Down the Walls. This was from 2004. This is when they released the Neon God. It was almost like a double release, The Rise and The Devise. This is from the Devise one. Frankie Banal on drums. The drums are right out front, you know, headphones. And what's a really, really cool little addition to this that a lot of songs that W.A.S.P. doesn't really have, there, little keyboard in there. A little keyboard thrown in there. So, you know, it's something different because you always got that, you know, the powerful vocals, the ripping guitar riffs. So, you know, they threw a little keyboard in there, something different. So there's my first three. Super, super deep.
Steven, BB's picks, what do you got?
My Wicked Heart. The start reminds me of Maiden for some reason. The intro to the song reminds me of Maiden. I like the, right after the song gets going, I like the ahs, that kind of vocal harmony thing that they threw into the melody, I thought was really good. And it reminds me in places of L.O.V.E. Just okay. In certain places, not the song as a whole, but in certain places, maybe it's the riffing or the way the melody goes, it reminds me of L.O.V.E. So check that out. Listen to it with that in mind. See if you hear the same thing. But
is that Jen's nickname for you? L-O-V-E, machine?
No, I'm flat out the love machine.
Mr. V8. I mean the drink, not the fucking engine.
All night long.
I'm sorry to interrupt you.
No, it's good. So, yeah, Love Machine, L-O-V-E, you guys knew what I was talking about. So that's the way I see My Wicked Heart. Locomotive Man from Unholy Tear. I like it. But again, does it need to be 6 minutes long? I don't think so. And that might be a reoccurring theme with me for some of these songs. I'm not a fan of the longer tunes, and I also think that Blackie may be his own worst enemy sometimes when it comes to some of this shit, because I think some of these songs lack somebody on the producer side just saying, man, we can cut out this, this, and this. This is a kick-ass song with, 3.5 minutes to 4 minutes, not 6 minutes.
Paul Stanley syndrome.
Huh?
Paul Stanley syndrome.
Yeah. And then Tear Down the Walls from the Neon God. I'm quite surprised that he had something on here from Neon God, but I like it. It sounds muddy to me, though. I don't know it. I'm not a huge fan of this record, either part, but I do like this song. I think it sounds muddy. But I like it, and it sounds like it's recorded live. Like it's recorded live in the studio with the band just hashing it out. And then I like the Leslie at the end, the Leslie speaker at the end with the keyboards. That's nice. Gives it that old school Deep Purple sound.
All right.
So cool. There you go.
Me for BB songs, My Wicked Heart from Dying from the World. It picks up like, actually it's a song right after my first pick, and it's a great tempo. It's got the double bass drums, the background vocals are great, the guitar tone from Daryl Roberts is fucking excellent. There's a really cool vocal effect like in the middle of the song, and like Steven, I'd like the woos. That's horrible, but Daryl Roberts really fucking tears it up on this solo on this song. It's fucking excellent. The band in the background, they're just a chugging machine. I love the cymbal stops like right after the solo. That is a really cool part of the song. Locomotive Man, good rocker from Unholy Terror. Again, very, very layered vocals on this song also, which unless you're triggering vocals, background shit, you're not going to pull this song off live. And we got to see them live. And there's a lot of triggered background vocals because, like, you could hear Blackie Lawless singing background vocals when the bass player's singing background vocals, and it's not the bass player fucking singing, it's Blackie fucking singing. So they definitely used a lot of layered stuff there. Tearing Down the Walls, like BB, I love it's got that heavy Hammond organ-like sound. Frankie Banal on drums is fucking excellent. The solo's ripping. The tempo picks up during the solo, and, like, there's like a fucking outro keyboard solo, like a Hammond organ solo that takes this song out. And I think it's really cool. It's very different for W.A.S.P. It's got that different feel to it. And but very cool. What do you think, BC?
Daryl Roberts. I think the last two guitar players he had are just so underrated. And they're playing on these albums. My Wicked Heart, crank it to a new Locomotive Man. I like that one. And Tear Down the Walls is Neon Gods. I mean, I like those two albums. I think we talked about these touch real quickly one time.
We did talk about them.
If you sit there really scope these, they're good.
I like them.
They're very, I think his later stuff, like you said, there was fun W.A.S.P. The later stuff is...
And they're serious W.A.S.P.
You have to be a real fan to really delve into this stuff, because I think a lot of it gets overlooked. You should not.
All right. Hey, Steven.
You.
You want to know why Locomotive Man is 6 minutes long?
Why?
Because Blackie Lawless is the producer.
That's my point. Exactly my point.
My ball, and I'm a pitch. And bat first, or I'm going home. All right.
I got news for you. Any W.A.S.P. record that doesn't have Blackie Lawless as the producer, Blackie's still calling the shots.
I'm sure. Yeah. You know it. Absolutely. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. All right, BC, what do you got for us?
I'm going to start off with the latest one, Golgotha, Slave of the New World Order, with Doug Blair. I mean, it starts off with that slight organ and guitar, which very slow, mellow, and then kicks into a more upbeat song for me, but... Narrow this right down to this song is Doug fucking Blair. The ripping solo on that. And then at the end, he goes back into like this second solo almost, I think. And I like the hey, hey, hey. It's cheesy, but I like it. Yeah. So, I mean, the solo playing on this whole album. Okay, second would be Scared to Death off Still Not Black Enough. Opens it the guitar chord, but I like the bass and drum sound on it. A lot of people, who is it? Blackie don't like the bass sound on it. I don't know why, but I think it's different.
Because he plays bass on it, so he's busting his own balls.
He's busting his own. He didn't like it. I like it though, Blackie.
He could have changed it.
Background vocals and sound a little bit different for W.A.S.P., I think. And again, the solo on that song just to me. And of course, my third pick's gonna be off. Controversial album from those guys, I guess. And a lot of people don't like the album. I don't know why. I didn't like it at first. I admit.
It's a grower.
It's a grower. It was definitely a grower. It's You off of Kill Fuck Dive from 1997. But the angry lyrics, I mean, just very. The music's more darker for W.A.S.P., I thought. Angry lyrics. Some say it's industrial. Some of the stuff on it, yeah.
It's got a tinge to it.
Not so much that song.
Not that song, no.
I think it's more dark song than industrial. But Kill Yourself for Me, you fucking suck. BB, what do you think?
Great picks. They're definitely all over the place, I think. Slaves of the New World kick in the beginning. It's really, really cool, and you already touched on it before. I like the extended solo at the end. Just really, really cool. Scared to Death, it's definitely different. It's a different sounding song for W.A.S.P., and once again, we're going to touch on the background vocals. It's just so cool to hear them. And then You. This is the heaviest song we're going to talk about tonight. It is so heavy, it's almost spooky. Like, it has that spooky feel to it. And it was just really, really, really cool to listen to that again. Because I haven't listened to that in a long time. But it's just so heavy. Like, you wish some of their other stuff that... sometimes sounds so similar that they would take another half a step and just get a little bit heavier like the song You. But sprinkle a little heavy on there, right?
Sprinkle a little more heavy.
You should get his heavy dust out and sprinkle it on there.
But yeah, good picks.
All right, for me, Slaves to the New World, Blackie can sound, I think he's extremely underrated as a vocalist. He can sound very soulful when he's singing. This song starts off a little slow, picks up at the chorus. The background vocals are great, layered once again. Fucking ripping guitar solo, Doug Blair, and the change of tempo after the first solo is really good. It's got little keyboards layered in there. Then it rips into another solo, and it just the second solo just fucking is one of the best solos on this fucking album. It's kick ass. damn, this guy can shred. But he keeps it sensible, though. Like, it's not like an Yngwie solo where it's just fucking out of control and no melodic sense to it at all. This guy just fucking plays these solos right in the fucking pocket, kicks ass. I like the hey, hey, heys and the woo, woo, woos in the song. The hey, hey, the little crowd things, that always works for me. I'm a sucker for that kind of shit. Scared to Death off of Still Not Black Enough, which this was supposed to be a solo album also, because Crimson Idol was supposed to be a solo album, and this one was supposed to be the follow-up to it, but it was put out under the W.A.S.P. moniker. Bob Kulick playing lead guitar on this, and it's definitely, you were right, BB, it's a different sound or I don't know when you guys said it, definitely a different sound for Bob Kulick. Really cool sounding. It's got like this female singing background vocals in it. The guitar during the verses has this kind of like underwater sound to it, like really kind of crazy. I like when the chorus kicks in. I love the no, 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 no. Just the back and forth of that part is really fucking cool. Great Bob Kulick solo, totally fits the song. I love his playing. It's just, but even like as the chorus fades out, there's some fucking ripping guitar underneath that. Bob Kulick is kick ass on this song. You from the KFC, I was gonna say KFC. From the KFD Kill Fuck Die album. Talk about a dark album. And you're right, BB. You said spooky. I have a kind of a scary sound in the beginning. Blackie's soft vocals in the beginning. Then he starts fucking screaming, you fucking suck. It's just like, holy fuck. Very intense. Like, this song fucking, like, first time I heard it, it fucking made my fucking heart pound. I was like, holy fuck. Totally different from the heavier shit of W.A.S.P. that W.A.S.P. was doing up to that point. Like, just like in total intense. And he starts yelling, fucking liar, fucking. I'm not a huge fan of the production of this album. It's a little like thin for me, maybe. But these type of songs, like, it works. The production works well, and like the fucking end is just, I wish you well in hell. Fucking just like fucking crazy shit, but very intense fucking song. Like I said, it fucking makes my fucking heart pound, and it's very cool. And so if they were ever doing like a fucking EKG yep. on me, and they put the song on, they'd fucking probably hospitalize me at that time. So, Steven, what do you got for BC's picks?
All right, so Slaves of the New World Order. I like that BC's given a little love to Golgotha. I guess he and I were the only ones that gave a little love to that record this go-around, but I like it. But, again, 7 minutes and 45 seconds long. Two fucking long. Stop with the 7 minute, 8 minute songs. I don't need it. This is a great song that could be great if it were 4 minutes long. Scared to Death off of Still Not Black Enough. I gotta be honest, I've never even heard of this record.
Really?
It wasn't on Spotify. I've never even heard of this record. I've never seen the album cover. So I like the song. I think the song's pretty good. But, again, it was new to me. I thought it was all right, though. Kill, Fuck, Die, that record. I don't know what to say about that record. But this song happens to be one of the songs that I do like off of this record. And then my notes are, yeah, this song's angry as fuck. So there you go. That's my 2 cents.
All right, cool. My first 3 picks, I'm going to go with the opening track from the Unholy Terror album, Let It Roar. Just a great quick rocker off of, opening track on it. Really cool background vocals. It's got a great double bass drumming. Frankie Benelli fucking tears it up on here. Or Sted Holland. It says that both of these guys drummed at different points on the album, but I'm not sure who the fuck plays on what song because it doesn't say. But whoever it is, fucking is really good. It's got crunching guitars. It's got the typical Blackie layered vocals that I've been talking about. The time change in the middle is really cool. But I'm actually surprised after I listened to this that I picked this song because there's no fucking guitar solo in it. Which is I listened to it and like, maybe I fucking missed it. I wasn't paying attention. But there is no guitar solo in this song. But it is good though. Fucking rocks. I picked Shadow Man off of the Dying for the World album released in 2002. It's got a kind of a slow build to it. A little ominous start to it. The kick and riff is really cool and the whole band gets in on it. Really cool vocals from Blackie. I love that it's got the hey, hey, hey in it again. That I'm always a sucker for that shit. I love the way that he sings on this song. It's got a cool grinding background when they do the hey, hey, hey's is fucking really cool. And it's actually the debut solo for Doug Blair. And fucking, it's really good. Fucking, he's right in the pocket there. It's not too crazy to start, but it's very melodic and ripping at the same time. Just a great start to the fucking album. And then I delved into the Crimson Idol album from 1992, Arena of Pleasure. I think it's just a fucking fantastic fucking song. Like I said before, this was supposed to be a solo album. Bob Kulick plays lead guitar on it. With the exception of this song, Doug Aldrich actually plays the fucking lead guitar on this song. And he fucking absolutely rips on this fucking song. Frankie Benelli on drums, fucking solid as ever. And I think Frankie Benelli, when he plays on these W.A.S.P. albums, he shines so much more on the W.A.S.P. stuff than he does on the Quiet Riot stuff. I mean, he's solid and in the pocket, but it's a different kind of, you know, vibe for Quiet Riot than the W.A.S.P. But he's just a fucking monster drummer, and I would rather see him drum in W.A.S.P. than fucking Quiet Riot. So maybe these shows that he's missing for Quiet Riot, maybe he's practicing for fucking W.A.S.P. BC. You know, I can only fucking hope. You know, and this is, you know, if you want to check out more talk about this album, this is one of the albums we talked about when we did our concept album episode. A lot more in-depth review of that. The song just kicks a fucking major ass. Doug Aldrich fucking rips it up on it. Definitely one of my favorite W.A.S.P. songs. And the lead work is just fucking absolutely amazing on here. So Doug Aldrich, you know, he kicked ass in W.A.S.P. I mean, this guy can fucking make any band fucking good. Fucking absolutely love it. Steven.
So you're saying you fucking love it.
I absolutely fucking love it.
Alright, so let it roar off Unholy Terror. I gotta say, Unholy Terror, out of everything that's on these lists, was a huge surprise for me. I'd heard of the record, but I wasn't that familiar with the record. I think I probably heard a few songs, but this came out in 2001, so I kind of missed this record because 2001, I wasn't necessarily listening to W.A.S.P. But love this record. I went down from start to finish getting through all this stuff and thought there is a whole lot of great material on the Holy Terror. I like this song, but overall, the record as a whole was a big surprise for me. Shadow Man, Dying for the World, it's heavy. I dig it. That was basically my notes. Dying for the World, again, is a record that just isn't in my wheelhouse for W.A.S.P. stuff. W.A.S.P. stuff. You got to have a list for that. And then Arena of Pleasure from Crimson Idol. I like that song, but I actually prefer like Invisible Boy and Dr. Rocker, and again, here we go again, 6 minutes long with this song. So that's my thoughts on these three songs. I will say this, it's already come up several times in this episode, Blackie Lawless is an underrated singer, and you know, he's one of the most recognizable voices to me. Like, I can instantly recognize his voice. And so where guys like himself and maybe Ozzy aren't necessarily the most technically proficient singers in the world, they are easily very recognizable voices. You can put on an Ozzy record or you can put on a W.A.S.P. record and are, you know, automatically identify those two singers, right?
Yeah, you instantly know who those guys are, definitely. But I, you know, all the Ozzy fans are going to fucking hate me, but I think that Ozzy is not as good of a singer as fucking Blackie Lawless. I think that Blackie's got a little more range. He can give you that soft, like, soulful kind of thing, and then that fucking kind of shit. And, I mean, not to take anything away from Ozzy, they're both fucking great, but I think a little more technically, I think Blackie's got it over Ozzy.
I think he's definitely a stronger singer, yeah. I would agree with that statement.
All right, BB.
All right, Let It Roar. Another harmony is on this song, another great one, but it's one of those songs that's heavy from start to finish. Love it. Shadow Man from Dying of the World. The chanting of the hey, hey, hey was the
selling point for me in this song. And another ripping solo, as you know, 99% of these songs have. And Arena of Pleasure, best song on the album. Like you said, Doug tears it up. The Crimson Idol is one of those concept albums that needs to be out there, that people need to listen to more. But Arena of Pleasure, great, great tune. Like I said, the best song in the album.
Yeah, Let It Roar off Unholy Terror. I mean, good rocker, and I was surprised you picked it. No song.
I was too, and I'm like, this song fucking rocks. And then I put it down and I wrote all my shit on it. And then I'm like, oh, I must have missed the solo, because sometimes I'll blank out when I'm like listening to something. And I thought, well, maybe I missed it or someone was talking to me. But then I'm like, no, there's no solo, but I fucking left it on there. Still rocks.
Still rocking. Shadow Man, I'm Dying for the World. I mean, like you guys both said, it's in multiple songs on his. Really?
It is. Yeah. It's, yeah.
And it fits in every one of them.
Yeah.
It does.
You cannot go wrong.
There's no extra use of the haze in W.A.S.P.
And Darryl Roberts, I mean, here's a guy you really never heard of even when he was playing W.A.S.P.
No, he's the guy that I thought was Doug Blair in a lot of these things, and until I corrected myself.
Gotta give Darryl some credit.
Yeah.
And Arena Pleasure off Crimson Idol. I mean, I loved that whole album. And like I said, Doug Aldridge can make anything fucking gold. And he definitely makes this song gold.
He does. He tears it up. All right, Dylan, do you have any comments on the first picks here?
I didn't recognize most of them.
All right. All right. I got just nothing
being,
after that.
Being
I got
honest,
nothing.
Just being honest.
Can I share my playlist from Apple Music to you? Is that a thing I can
do? Yeah.
I'll do that. Maybe if you get a chance to listen to it, it'll be good listening to you on the plane going to Vegas.
Yeah.
I'll share it with you. And
be telling
Dylan, if you promise to listen to this playlist, I'll share it with you. And then with the exception, everything's on there with except for two songs, a song that I picked and a song that BC picked. Everything else is on there. And if I share this with you, you promise to listen to it and report back?
Sure.
All right. Someone remind me, because I'll probably forget and it'll just go away. All right. So there's our first three picks for everybody. Some deep tracks for W.A.S.P. So. Guys, seriously, if you have not checked out these albums from W.A.S.P., check them out. Some of the ones you probably guys have never heard of. Fucking, you may have heard of the Crimson Idol, but like, Still Not Black Enough. Steven didn't even know of that one. That's fucking great. Actually, I literally had that fucking CD in my hand yesterday. Kill Fuck Die is great. And Hell Dorado. I don't even know if anybody picked anything off of that. Maybe. Mm-hmm. But Unholy Terror, Dying for the World, Neon God Part 1 and 2, Dominator, Babylon, and Golgotha. Just great stuff out there. Get into these albums, because there's and if W.A.S.P. would fucking tour a little more, maybe a lot of these songs wouldn't be deep tracks because people would be more familiar with them. So let's we'll get back into it in a couple minutes. We'll take a quick break. All right, so the song you guys are going to check out this week, it's from the band Motor Sister from their 2015 album called Ride. It has guys from Anthrax in there, Scott Ian's in there, and Rob Correggio's in there from when he was in Anthrax. And what's the other bands guys have there?
What now?
The other guy's a Motor Sister. It's a, isn't there a guy from that's the other band.
I was
going
to say
band.
I only know okay. Scott Ian off the top
yeah.
of my head.
So seriously, but anyway, check this out. The band is called Motor Sister, and the song is called "This Song Reminds Me of You." This song absolutely fucking tears it up. So check it out. It's the chorus is kind of, I don't like the chorus in this song, but just fight through the chorus though, because there's some fucking kick ass fucking guitar playing in this song. Check it out. This song reminds me of you from Motor Sister 2015 from the album Ride.
You were. times have I told myself this will be the last time? Music always takes me back to when you broke my heart.
Right, Hidden Gem time, people. Hope you enjoyed that song. It was kick-ass. And we'll start off our Hidden Gems. We'll go with Mr. Grown Up Rock himself, Mr. Stephen J. Michael. I don't know what the J means.
The J is for jerk off.
Anyway. I swear to God I was going to fucking say that.
I'll do it for you. You're welcome.
Anytime, my friend. What do you got for us for a gem?
All right, so I'm going to spotlight a band that we played on the Spotify episode of Growin Up Rock. This is a band from Canada, put out an album in 92. They got a few records out now. The band is called Von Groove, and it's just straight ahead, hair metal, hard rock, great guitar riffs, great harmonies. The whole album is great, but if you want to, you know, find one tune to see if you like them, go ahead and check out the lead-off track, Once Is Not Enough. They're just a great, solid rock band. Love it.
Steven, when you had, was that the first song you guys played on that episode?
I don't know where it got played.
Okay, because there was one song that you guys, and I don't remember you saying what the band was, and I'm like, what the fuck song is this? And so I'm thinking maybe that's the one, so I hope it's that one. I mean, all the songs you played on, they were great, but I think there was one song that you guys didn't say what it was, so I'm going to have to check that out, because if it was the first song, it fucking kicked ass. So
we often don't say what they are anymore, just because we felt like that was getting too, just sort of contrived. So it's always in the show notes, whatever songs we play, but if it started out with some chick moaning, yeah, that's once is not enough.
I'm going to let that stay right where it is there.
That should be a PSA to all listeners. Check the show notes, because there's some really interesting stuff, and a lot of work sometimes goes into the show notes, especially for, hint, hint, the Potter Than Hell podcast.
Exactly. I mean, listeners, they just want to listen to the episode and move on, but oftentimes they're missing out on stuff we put in the show notes, because I write some crazy shit in our show notes just to see whether people are reading them.
Yeah, I do that as well.
I'm actually looking at the show notes from this show, and it doesn't say. Because I looked at the show notes. That's why I said that.
It doesn't say the music provided by at the bottom.
Nope.
Really?
Well, that was,
what are you looking at?
I don't know. It's on Apple things here. There's a link to get the full story, but that's too much work for someone like me.
That's right. You got to go to the full story. Just hit the link. You're right.
See, that's a lot of work.
Yeah, can you,
that's not a lot of work. Just put your little foot
in the story part of it. What are you doing?
I still don't fucking. Oh, there we go. Okay.
He didn't want to use his thumbprint and use show more.
Okay. All right. Okay. The first one I was talking about. Now, when you put them in the show notes, are they in order?
No. It was Diablo Trucker was the first song.
All right, that's the one I was talking about then. That fucking rocks. But, I mean, there weren't any bad songs on there, so I will go back and I will definitely check out Von Groove. I've heard that name before, but Diablo Trucker, man, that fucking ripped. That was fucking excellent. But Von Groove, Once Is Not Enough, cool pick. Yep. I will definitely have to check those guys out. Now, what do you got, Dylan?
So my hidden gem is from a band that is kind of out of format, but the album isn't. The band is called Bayside. They're kind of a pop punkish band, the kind that would play a Warped Tour. They just came out with a new album called Interrobang, and it's actually a really rocking album. There's a lot of cool solos, a lot of good guitar riffs in it. Really catchy album. Definitely a good starting on point if you want to get into that band. I really enjoyed it, and it's a band I haven't heard from in a while. So
what's it called? Interrobang?
Interrobang. It
sounds like a new kind of porn.
Well, no, that's that's actually a punctuation. It's a
Interrobang.
It's a combination of a question mark and an exclamation point. It's like a legit punctuation mark.
Oh, that's way too fucking in depth for me.
It's not. It's literally a question mark and an exclamation point together.
Interrobang.
Like somebody getting interrogated while they're getting banged. That's what I took away.
What are you doing? All right.
Basically, it looks like that.
Oh, that's. See that? That's too smart.
It looks like a Russian sickle.
That's too intellectual for
it's
me.
A Russian sickle over there.
But we'll check it out. The Bay City Rollers in Interrobang. All right. I'm sorry. I'm just in a fucked up mood right now. All right, BB, what do you got for us? The returning gem for BB.
Oh, all right. Let's go all the way down south to Louisiana from the hard rock band Baton Rouge. Everybody wants to talk about that song, Walks Like a Woman. How about the song that comes off the same album of Shake Your Soul, Bad Time Coming Down? Great guitar work on that. This is that album that, you know, it's only one song that sold the album that not many people bought. But there's some really good tunes on it, and Bad Time Coming Down is one of them songs that never really made the radio, but it was just a really, really cool rockin'
song. Did you actually listen to this song?
I did.
It's a fucking ballad.
It is not a ballad.
I know. I'm fucking banging everybody.
God damn it.
God damn it. All right, BC, what do you got?
That was
Wow.
Whoa.
Going through my...
That was on the Interrobang video.
Wow. Interrobang.
I was going through my iPod, right? The little thing I have.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Is that what Renee calls it? I don't know.
No, not she definitely didn't say you fuck like a beast. Go ahead.
Not that little thing. Another little thing.
Oh, God.
And the one with the music on it. I came across
the thing that you complain about that doesn't fucking work all the time.
Yeah,
all right, that thing.
That's funny. That's what she said too.
See, I was gonna say I don't know what Ray calls that either.
So, anyways, I had something put on there that I totally forgot about until today. I was like, so I really fastly checked these guys out. They're called Hell's Addiction, and they have an album out and two EPs. But this is off their Saturatory Nuisance EP. because I'm just going to go with the song for right now. It's We're on Fire. There's a video for it, too. I mean, fuck. I don't know how it is. I put this on here and didn't listen to it.
Hmm.
Check it out, damn it.
Never heard of them.
Hell's Addiction.
Hell's Addiction.
That's the perfect segue to check out Growin Up Rocks.
I was going to say, you guys mentioned that band, Steven. You guys have played those guys. Actually, you had an interview with those dudes.
Yeah, just recently we released the Crank It Up, Have You Heard, with Hell's Addiction.
Yeah, when BC said that, I'm like, you guys just fucking did that.
I was going to say. I'm going to throw it aside. I'm like, who the hell are these guys?
Did you get it from them?
I don't remember.
I think I told you to play it because I heard it from them.
That might have been it. It's on there.
I think I did, because I think it was, because actually, Steven, I listened to your episode when you played them the first time. And then I'm like, holy shit, these guys are good. So I put both their albums on my phone, and then I sent it to BC, check these guys out. So there you go. Good crossover.
Ta-da.
There you go. Way to go, BC.
All right, BC. what song did you say?
We're on Fire. And I got into her album a little bit too. I mean, it's just fucking killer shit.
All right, I'm going to go with a little gem here from 1984, classic album. We haven't talked about these guys a lot, and the band is, you may have heard of these guys.
I swear to God, I was just going to say that.
They started out in Birmingham, England, and they were called Earth first, and then they changed their name to Black Sabbath.
Wind and Fire.
There you go. Tower. They're actually Tower of Power.
You missed September. You're a month late.
Oh, see that? God damn it. No, I'm going to talk about the first, I think it's the debut album from White Lion, Fight to Survive. Just a really good classic, you know, if you want to call it hair metal, call it whatever the fuck you want to call it. Just a great album. It's got Broken Heart on there. Fight to Survive is really good. I'll Burn in Hell. Just a really good album. And if you get the, I don't even know what it is. I don't even know if it's on fucking streaming, but I have the CD at the house. It's got some bonus live tracks on there. It has Hungry, Don't Give Up, Lonely Nights, Sweet Little Lovin', Broken Heart, Fight to Survive, and Tell Me. But just a great album. I think White Lion was a really good band. And Mike Tramp is still out there doing stuff on his own, playing some White Lion stuff and doing his own thing there. Steven, was he on the Monsters Rock Cruise last year?
Yes, he was.
I thought it was. Did you get a chance to see him at all? How was he?
I saw him on the island. He played a show on one of the islands, and he's just playing acoustic. He's kind of doing the same thing Kip Winger does a lot of, and yeah, I mean, he's fine, you know. It's all good. Whereas Kip Winger and Jason Beadler are really entertaining because they're actually funny dudes, you know. They're pretty,
right.
I mean, they're fun to go see play acoustically. Mike Tramp is just more kind of straight ahead. Yeah, so.
All right, cool. Remind me in Vegas when I see you. I have a Kip Winger story for you.
I got a WASP story. Remind me to tell that here in a few minutes.
Okay, sounds cool. All right, there's our hidden gems for this week. Sorry, Dylan, that I busted your balls there. He's got Bayside, not the Bay City Rollers, with the album's called Inner Bang. God, we got to make up some.
Interrobang.
I'm sorry, Interrobang. Even better. Interrogation porn.
Interrogation.
Steven's got.
Why did you touch it? Why?
Steven's got Von Groove. Once is not enough. BB's got a little Baton Rouge. Bad Time Coming Down. BC's got Hell's Addiction. We're on Fire. That we discovered this band through Steven and Sonny's awesome podcast, Growin' Up Rock. And I have White Lion, Fight to Survive album from 1984. Some great shit on there. Just a great band. And like you said, Mike Tramp is the only one really doing anything right now. And Vito Bratta, that is the guitar player in White Lion, he has absolutely nothing to do with the music business anymore. He's just out there. He's like some kind of painter or something.
He doesn't touch guitar.
Yeah. So he has nothing to do with that.
Listen to this.
Hey, maybe if he's painting, he could open up for fucking Kiss.
You never know.
Yeah. Ooh, that's right.
He could be the new guy. It'll be like Kiss
on the European leg
with a White Lion behind them.
Ooh. Unibrow.
He's busy touching himself to Entero porn.
Streaming live. He can stream it behind him. I'll tell you what, Paul Stanley's missing out. God damn it. all right. Let's get back into some WASP here. BC, I think BC got fucked up on the details here. So whatever you got, BC, give me your three songs.
Please stop doing that.
Why? You don't like that?
It's from the Otero porn.
Yeah.
He's the stunt tongue. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I'm going to go back to
Golgotha.
With the Godless Run.
I'm sorry.
I fucked up here. I'm reading everything backwards. I'm getting confused with my two lists here. Golgotha. It's the last song, I believe, on the album, my memory serves me correct. Slow start again, like a lot of things on this. To me, it's been said a million times already, Blackie's vocals on this song. And like I said, he's a very underrated guy. And again, just like my last pick off this album, it goes back to Doug fucking Blair.
Fucking Blair.
Just the guitar parts.
Rebel in the DFB.
As he's doing the vocals and he has a little guitar parts behind it, I dig that in the guitar solo. And then at the end, there's that shred fest. Mini shred.
Hey, BC?
Fest. Yes.
Did you just call an audible?
No. Did it?
Yes.
I think you did.
No.
Because it was going to be Scream Until You Like It.
Oh, you guys did get the text?
I got the text.
What happened to Godless Run?
No, that's not on there. I just said the wrong album. That's all.
He's not going in the order that he sent the list, I think.
But he never had Golgotha from Golgotha on there.
Yeah, that's one of the last. He changed.
I caught audible in a text message back and forth.
I didn't see that. Bad.
You're forgiven. But, I mean, that's what I think about that song. Now I'm going to go back up to Babylon with Doug Valerian guitar again. Is a Godless Run. To me, I like I don't know if it's a synthesizer intro. I would say that's what it is. I don't know. Mid-tempo song. A little almost spoken Blackie word.
Right.
Not too much. And again, Doug Blair. It must be the name Doug. Doug Aldridge. Doug Blair. I mean,
the name we talked about tonight.
Blackie needs to hold on to this. Hold on to this guy. I'm sorry.
Hold on to him like Grim Death. Hold on to him, Grim Death. Which I must say is not far away.
And then I'm going to get away from Doug Blair. I'm getting fucked up real bad.
Boy, oh boy.
Whew. I'm going to go to Detonator with Deal with the Devil. I mean, it's a cover of Lizzie Borden. I mean, no, I'm sorry. Deal with the Devil.
Detonator? The Rat album?
Dominator.
Okay.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Okay.
He's going to see if Pierce is going to do the strut to some Wasp.
Yeah.
But I picked this song because it's a... For Wasp, it has like a fun feel, I think. Musically, it's more up-tempo than a lot of the other stuff we talked about tonight, except for the earlier stuff.
And that one's actually Daryl Roberts on that one.
Daryl Roberts. As I said, right. I had to get away from Doug Blair for a little bit.
But that's the only song he plays on that album.
And then, to me, it was a fun feel, a very upbeat and good solo. And then I liked it goes into like a little jam, but he starts singing again. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I like songs that...
Have a guitar
in it.
I love a song that there's a vocalist and a guitar player and a drummer. I love it.
All right, Steven, what do you got? I know you don't have Golgotha, but Deal with the Devil and Godless Run.
He's familiar with Golgotha.
Yeah, I'm familiar with Golgotha. I think it's all right. It's a little bit slower for me, but, you know.
But the guitar parts in it.
The guitar parts are good. The record as a whole is great. So that's my thought on that. Godless Run from Babylon. Meh. It was just meh for me. I don't care for that tune all that much. Deal with the Devil from Dominator, though, I dug a lot. It's exactly what BC said. It's a bit of a throwback to old school rock and roll. So it's just fun. It kind of reminds me of the spirit of like something like off the first record. Yeah, it's just a kick-ass rock and roll tune. So I dig Deal with the Devil. That's my thought on those three scenes.
All right, cool. BB, what do you got for BC's songs here, my friend?
Golgotha. I love Religious Wasp. I don't know what it is with the
Born Again Blackie.
It is. I love the Born Again Blackie, like towards the later end of his career. Love it. Godless Run. You really surprised me on that one. You're really showing your softer side.
Is that too soft?
It's a little soft. That's a soft. You go from the heaviest one from you to Godless Run of the softest one. I'm like,
it's the soloing. It's the soloing.
Just fucking tears it up. I'm like, oh.
All right, I'll give you that. And Deal with the Devil from the greatest W.A.S.P. album ever released, Dominator. Fantastic song. I love the gritty vocals that he does on his album. I love the tone of his vocals. It just way to go on ending your album with the Dominator song. Good job.
All right, for me, Godless Run has got a little mellow start. Very heartfelt vocals from Blackie. A little introspective song for the dude. It picks up a little bit at a time, but this song's got a decent build to it. It doesn't go total fucking crazy at the end. But Doug fucking Blair is just fucking an amazing guitar player. Total soulful solo on this song. I think it's just fucking phenomenal. This outro solo is absolutely tears it up. Deal with the Devil. I think this song has a great rock and roll feel to it, kind of like a Chuck Berry kind of riff kind of thing to it. And actually, this song, when I was listening to it, I listened to it a couple times, and I was like, it wasn't hitting me. And I'm like, it's just kind of run of the mill, kind of like when he does Rock and Roll to Death is on that on the Deep Cuts album, kind of like that. But then, it fucking kicks up in the middle of the song. And then he just fucking, Daryl Roberts, it's the only song he plays on the album, just fucking rips it the fuck up. And I think that totally saves the song. The first part of the song, it's kind of run-of-the-mill rock and roll type, like I said, Chuck Berry kind of thing. But it's not what you're, you know, if you're listening to, you know, these albums, you know, if you're listening to Kill, Fuck, Die, Hell, Dorado, Unholy Terror, Dying for the World, Neon Gods 1 and 2, and then you get to Dominator, this is not the kind of song that you're used to listening to these fucking albums. And then it gets like, you know, your metal, like singing about different stuff. And then, boom, you got a rock and roll type song. It's kind of a cool switch. But, like, if you're in that mode, you're like, it doesn't fit with the rest of the album because it's got that rock and roll feel, not that, like, metal feel. But the fucking soloing in that fucking song absolutely fucking saves the song. Golgotha starts off a little mellow like a lot of the songs, but I mean, I'll tell you what, Blackie can fucking sing, man. Definitely he can fucking sing. Picks up a little for the chorus. It's got some cool melodies in it. And Golgotha, this is my song that I call fucking W.A.S.P. does fucking Striper. This is fucking definitely W.A.S.P. doing a fucking Striper song. Doug fucking Blair, MVP for Golgotha. And he plays great on this fucking Striper song with fucking Blackie Lawless singing. And Michael Sweet just took a fucking break on the song.
You know why I like the album Golgotha so much? Anyway.
Doug fucking Blair?
No, nothing to do with anybody playing on the album. It's a talk about religious W.A.S.P., Blackie, Born Again. This is the place where Jesus Christ, supposedly the area where he...
turned water into wine?
No, I want to say sacrifice, but not that. Anyways.
Was crucified?
He was crucified. Crucified, that's yes. What I'm thinking. Thank you very much. Little Liliax crucified. But the area is also known as, it's another word for skull. And in the in the mountainside, I guess it's, the way it looks like a skull with the eyes. And the
So BC's throwing some skulls in there.
I was delving into religion.
Whoa.
Blackie's making me born again, BC.
Good job, BC.
Born again, BC. Okay. BC's going to go to Blackie Lawless Bible Camp in the summer.
Instead of BC, he's going to start calling you BA. Born again.
Born again.
All right, BB, give us your three here.
To continue with the Neon God 1-2 from The Rise, I picked Wishing Well. Once again, Frankie Benelli's drums are all front in this song. It's just a great tune. And it's just one of those things that, you know, we talked about guitar players. You know, Frankie Benelli is really, really good on these two albums that they released. And it just seems like, for me, when I had the headphones in, the drums are out front. They sound fantastic. And, of course, Blackie's vocals are spot on. My next one, I picked the opening track from Dominator from 2007, Mercy. Like I said before, this is my favorite Wasp album. Crazy Religious on this album, Born Again Blackie. Love it. The vocals are awesome. The guitar work is amazing. Just a fantastic album. And I'm closing my list out with my favorite song off of The Dominator, Heaven's Hunting in Black. The organ, the way it starts, it just gives me goosebumps. I don't know what it is. The vocal, the lyrics of this song are just crazy. He got the actual Hung in Black from something that Abraham Lincoln said right after he saw like the death count of the Civil War. And he said, today's heaven, there's so many casualties, today's heaven hung in black. So he kind of switched it around to turn it into like a soldier from Iraq. So, we know a bunch of guys around here from Iraq was in the war. So it's kind of like touching in that way. So Heaven's Hung in Black is closing out my album or my list or whatever we're going to call this.
All right, cool. Steven, non-BBs.
Wishing Well. So Blackie is a huge fan of The Who. He's covered some of their songs in the past. This song, Wishing Well, reminds me of The Who's The Real Me. I like that tune, so I like this tune as well. But very, very reminiscent, if you listen to it, and the bass runs and everything, of The Who's The Real Me. Mercy from Dominator, I thought it was okay. I mean, it's all right. Heaven's Hung in Black, BB, I love you.
But too slow for Steven.
This is 7 minutes of meh to me. It was super boring to me. Just 7 minutes of slow, just, yeah, not for me.
All right. Let me go here. Where are we at? Wishing Well was the first one, right?
Wishing Well,
okay.
Yep.
Wishing Well. Not the Black Sabbath Wishing Well, by the way. From Neon God Part 1, The Rise. It's got more of the Hammond organ thing going on there. Kind of beefs up the song. Good rocker. It's the only song that Stett Holland plays drums on the album. Very good song. I enjoy it. Mercy, I love the chugging guitar sound at the beginning. It's got like a 3/4 like tempo. It's not mid-tempo, but it's not totally fucking rocking the fuck out. But it's cool. It's got that good grinded little grindage to it from the Dominator album. Great Doug Blair solo, a really good one. The outro solo is fucking really good in this one. Heaven's Hung in Black. I kind of like the keyboard, the da-na-na-na-na, like not a triumphant return, but just like a kind of a sad kind of people coming back from war kind of vibe to it. Another really soulful vocal performance from Blackie. Picks up a little bit when the guitar kicks in. It's got a really good solo by Doug fucking Blair. It's got a little chugging to it in the verse after the solo. I definitely knew that BB would pick this song. It's got an amazing solo at the end, and I'm just going to end this one with saying D-F-B. Doug fucking Blair. Just an amazing guitar player. You guys, if you like Wasp, just seriously check out these albums. The guitar playing on these albums, from Randy Piper and Chris Holmes to Bob Kulick and Doug Aldrich and Daryl Roberts and Doug Blair, the guitar playing and the fucking guitar soloing on these albums is just fucking totally worth the time spent listening to it. Absolutely fucking love them. And what do you think, BC?
I'm going to break away from the guitar players for once. And your first pick on Wishing Well off the Neon Gods Part 1. Frankie Valli, and not until you mentioned it before, did you mention you like him better than, say, Wasp. Remember he played for Faster Pussycat. I thought he was phenomenal then, too. It just seems like maybe he should put Quiet Riot to rest and go with some.
Have sticks will travel.
Yeah. Get out there and play some different groovy stuff.
Yeah, that's true.
I think that this music lends itself more to his drumming style than Quiet Riot. Quiet Riot, I think, is more of a subdued, more straightforward kind of stuff, and you can do a little bit more crazy shit in this Wasp stuff than you can in Quiet Riot. Because BC and I saw Quiet Riot for one show, Frankie Benelli, which is fucking bananas fucking playing. It was like fucking Yngwie Malmsteen on the fucking drums. It'd be like, metal help. and then, you know, bang your head, which is fucking crazy. But, like, you know, this music kind of lends itself a little more to that, you know, fast, like, drum-filling kind of shit where, you know, Quiet Riot songs don't really lend themselves to that. I'm sorry, BC. Right. I didn't mean to hijack your pick, but I totally agree with that.
Don't want
to
let you go.
Yeah, really. Fly, thunder, bird, fly.
That was the truth, though. He was fucking.
It was. It was fucking. He was off the chain that night.
It was good, but kind of overkill.
It was overkill.
It was overkill. Where was I? Mercy. Dominator. I mean, this album was. I mean, was it Dominator? What was before Dominator? El Dorado. All these albums. Like
Neon God Part 2 was before Dominator.
Okay, going back up to, say, Hail to Rotto back in 99, Kill, Fuck, Die. And these are albums that, when they first came out, I was like, okay. But the more they were definitely growers.
Yeah. I think, and no one picked any songs from Hail to Rotto on this list, which.
Shockingly.
It's kind of shocking. But if you listen to Hail to Rotto, that album is like almost like dead in the middle of all the W.A.S.P. albums. That album is more like the first three albums than it is the rest of the catalog, the heavier shit. It's more of a fun album. It's got like Dirty Balls on there, the song, and like a lot of more fun partying, sexual type, more Indie first movie. Three album W.A.S.P. kind of mm-hmm. stuff on Hail to Rotto. So definitely an album that you might want to check out if you say I'm only a fan of the original W.A.S.P., you know, whatever the fuck that means. But if you really only and haven't given the newer stuff a chance and you want to kind of harken back to those first three albums, Hail to Rotto is definitely an album for you to check out because there's a lot of cool stuff on there. And and that was one where, Chris Holmes fucking shines. There's a lot of crazy good shit on there, but it's more of the first three album type of W.A.S.P. Go ahead, BC. I'm sorry.
And it's thrown in the middle of Kill, Fuck, Die, and Dying for... Where the Heaven Hums in Black. I mean, love that song. It's mellow. I know everybody's saying out there it's very mellow, but I like mellow Blackie.
He's a very soulful singer. Yeah. I really think he is. He pulls it off.
He pulls it
yeah,
off.
Yeah, he does.
You know. Like you said, he's an Aussie type guy, but he pulls it off good for what he does.
Yeah,
absolutely. For the music of it. Sure. Definitely. All right, Steven, what do you got for your last three, my friend?
My last three are as follows. I'm going to go back. Let me say this up front. So my songs that I picked, I tried to kind of cover a little bit of all the eras of W.A.S.P. So I have stuff at the beginning, something from the middle, and something from the end. But The Flame from the debut album. The debut album is just a fantastic, great record. And when I went back to revisit this record, The Flame isn't necessarily a song that stuck out to me as one that I remember that I really liked. But when I started listening to it, I was like, you know, I really enjoy this song. It's a bit of an old school rock and roll feel. I love the melody in The Flame, the chorus. So The Flame is my next pick. After that, we're going back to The Last Command because I absolutely love the song Jack Action. How can you not like a song that kicks in with cowbell, baby? Come on. So I
that's
love
what
the
Stephen J. Michael stands for. Stephen Jack Action.
That's right. Stephen Jack Off Action. Yeah, I love the cowbell, and I love the driving riff and the machine gun at the end. It's just a kick-ass song. And then last, like I told you earlier, Unholy Terror was really the surprise album for me because not being as familiar as I am with some of the other ones when I started listening to this record to prepare for tonight's episode. That's really, really a great record. And I picked the song Charisma, not the Kiss cover. This is Charisma from Unholy Terror, and I love the slower grind and the chord structure, and I think this song is just a great pocket groove. So Charisma is my last song.
Very good picks there, very good picks. I'll go first on this one. Jack Action, like you said, how can you go wrong with cowbell starting the song off? Just fucking excellent. More cowbell, baby. Mid-tempo rocker from The Last Command. Really cool song.
I always dug this one. Stephen Riley is definitely looking for some Jack action, and so is Stephen Michael on this song, I got to say. And the solos kind of just run in the middle in this one, but I totally agree with Stephen. I love the machine gun at the end. Fucking really cool. Charisma, like I said, not the Gene song, but another deep cut from Unholy Terror. And actually, you can really say it, this whole fucking album is just all deep cuts, but it's a great album. The song's got a great groove to it. I love the, you can hear like the marching boots during the song, during this one part of the song. I love the pace of it. I love the just how he sings it. The production is really good, more layered vocals. It's got a great plotting end to the song. I really like that. The Flame from the first album. You definitely gotta pick something from the first fucking album. Just like goddamn excellent, great rocker from the debut album. I love the great choruses, great Tony Richards drums. The drums are really good on this song. They really stand out on this song, I think, on the album. The first album is produced really great. This is one of the songs we talked about on our debut album episode, like way the fuck back, a couple actually, which is weird to say, a couple of years ago. But just great. Randy Piper and Chris Holmes, I think they were a great guitar duo. I think if they kind of stayed together after a while, I think they would have continued along with the vibe that the band had going with the fun Wasp that I talked about earlier. And they were just a cool duo. So once Randy Piper left the band, Blackie Lawless went to rhythm guitar and Johnny Rodd came in on bass. And so it was just like a one-man, lead guitar player in the band, because Blackie didn't play any lead at all. So I think you kind of lost a little bit when Randy Piper went out there, because you didn't have, and no disrespect to Chris Holmes at all, because this dude fucking tears the fuck up, but you lose a little bit of the melodic sense, I think, there. But, I love it. You know, Baby, I Got the Gasoline and You Got the Sparks, fucking another one that's fucking gold. And it's got a really cool solo in it that's like really short, but a good song. And I'm glad Steven picked one from the first album. And you may hear something else from the first album coming up pretty soon. BB.
Yeah, the way I had this written down, this is a great, great three-song closer. The Flame, fantastic. Just to show what a great 80s hard rock song is all about. A fantastic song. You know, you hear this and you can't understand why these guys weren't more popular than they actually were, because they never got the push. Then you got the middle, Jack Action. What I really loved about this song, the different pitch of the solo. You know, we've been talking about Doug Blair all night long, but the way the solo, the pitch of it was a little bit higher than you're used to. And that was really caught my ear. I thought it was really, really cool. And the charisma, it's just proof that Blackie Lawless and W.A.S.P. just got better with time. And these three songs are just proof of what a great 80s song it was, to charisma, just a heavy metal riff that put them out there. And I just can't understand how they didn't get the praise that they should have gotten in the 80s, and why people don't listen to them now. With this charisma song is such a really good riffing song, and I don't understand like what happened here, like between the Flame and the charisma, how people kind of lost W.A.S.P. I don't know, because they don't tour, or people don't listen to freaking music anymore, or what. But it's just a great bookend of two songs that shows like a history of what this band has become. It's just a fantastic three album closer. BC.
The Flame, after a debut album, I mean, cranking song. I mean, I think this is a very rough sounding, but sounding great for their debut. And we go with the next one, Jack Action off at Last Command. Who's looking for him?
Jack Action.
And like I said, I love the little at the very end. Back in the day.
Get the 50 cal going.
And again, coming back to Unholy Terror, which, until this episode, I forget how good these albums were.
Yeah.
With Charisma.
What is my life? All right, very cool. All right, I'm sorry. Did I miss someone?
Oh, did you go over these?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Okay.
My bad.
Before we go, I want Dylan to give us... Give me three W.A.S.P. picks. Any three.
Okay. I'm going to go Wild Child off the bat. Real Me, I love their cover of an awesome Who song, though I think the Who version is better. That's just me being biased, being a big Who fan as I am. And Chainsaw Charlie.
Yeah.
Probably my three that I would pick off the top of my head.
All right, Wild Child. What was the second one?
Real Me. Because I'm a Who stan. Chainsaw Charlie. You know? And Chainsaw Charlie, yeah.
All right, cool. Three very cool songs. Fucking Wild Child is like probably one of the most well-known W.A.S.P. songs. Fucking excellent. Real Me, Who cover, of course. Really cool. BB, I'm sorry to tell you that Van Hagar copied off of W.A.S.P. You watch the Real Me video, they did this fucking make you throw up circular fucking video rotating fucking stage before fucking Van Halen did it for fucking Pound Cake.
Or right. Round and Round?
Is it Round and Round or is it Pound Cake?
Round and Round.
Oh. I lose track because all them songs suck anyways.
but that's why they called it Round, Round and Round.
Oh, was it? Oh. fucking to be like the fucking kids on fucking that movie. They go on, they do all the fucking chew the...
Sandlot.
The Sandlot. I couldn't think of that. They smoke out. They fucking chew all the fucking chewing tobacco. Then they go on the fucking Roundup and fucking throw the fuck up. That's what happens to me when I hear fucking Van Hagar. I go on, I put some fucking chew in my mouth, go on the Roundup, and throw the fuck up.
As tequila plays in the background.
Yeah. Oh, man.
The fuck right. album was awesome. You watch your tongue.
Thank you, Mr. Michael.
I have a tally of the albums that were...
All right, you know, and actually, after we do that, I didn't do my last three songs, but go ahead, Dylan. Let me do the final fucking tally. Because BB's like pointing at me. I'm like, all right, like we're good. And he's like, you didn't do your songs. I'm like, oh, you're right. I fucking did. another song from the Still Not Black Enough album, I Can't. Just a great song. Total under the radar album. So under the radar, Steve and Michael never even fucking heard of it. And Bob Kulick plays great on there. Frankie Benelli on there. What?
I don't have that on my list.
You don't have that one on there? Does anybody else have that on their list?
No.
No?
Thank you.
No.
I think that's the one that
it used to be. No.
You changed it.
I did change. I changed it from the Inside the Electric Circus. I changed it.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's right. Me. All right. Well, I can't. Well, listen. Go check that song the fuck out. It's really good. All right?
It's really good.
And actually, if you listen to this song, it's actually a song that would fit great on fucking Crimson Idol. And then I did Crazy from Babylon, fucking another under the radar W.A.S.P. album. Just a massive fucking kick ass fucking rocker start to finish. Another album opening track. Doug Blair fucking leading rhythm guitar is fucking great. Mike Duda on bass. Mike Depke on drums. The song's got a great groove to it. I love Blackie's. He's got a little low-type vocals in it. It picks up in the verses as it goes along. I love the feeling that he puts into these songs. Like I said before, he's an extremely underrated singer, very distinct sounding. Doug Blair just fucking slams the fuck out of the solo in this song. And it's got a great build back to the chorus, a great song. The outro solo is fucking fantastic, too. And I went back to the first album for Bad, B-A-D. Just a classic deep track from the first one, from the first album. Cool song that has a great pace. B-A-D. What, BC? Make your mom and daddy sad. Fucking, you know, what more rebellion can you fucking get than the band telling you to make your mom and dad sad? The lineup on that album is, you know, Blackie, Randy Piper, Chris Holmes on lead guitar, fucking Tony Richards on fucking drums. The solo's great. Not sure who actually plays what on that first album. I would like to know who plays what on that album. There's some really cool pinch harmonics on that album. See that? It could be unbearded fucking Chris Holmes doing that. You never know. So I had to throw one from the first album on there. Just a great fucking album. And there you have it. Steven, what do you think?
Wait, Steven, before you go, don't you love how the other Steven sends out a list and he doesn't even go in the order of the list he sends out?
Exactly.
Thank you. This is why I had to take a vacation. I can't handle the pressure.
I'm going to have to look back. You were banned for substances. Don't give me that shit.
Oh.
I don't blame anybody. I don't criticize anybody for wanting to take a vacation from Mr. Wright. He's crying at
You'll see me on vacation this week, fucker.
Exactly. Don't you worry. I'll be sipping on my wine right for you. So, yeah, the good news is that if Tony fucking Blair is looking for some jack action, Steve Wright's the man to give it to him. So.
I just may. If the room's dark enough, you never know.
So there you go. But Crazy from Babylon, my notes are, it's meh. For me, I do like the tune after Live to Die Another Day. So that was my notes for Crazy. Bad, how can you go wrong with the debut? I love the debut. Bad's just another example of kick-ass debut record. And then last, the tune that he was supposed to pick, Inside the Electric Circus, absolutely love it. I didn't love this record when it first came out. But this tune I loved from the get-go. So Inside the Electric Circus, you should put that back on your list, Jack Action.
I will have Dylan put that in our Spotify playlist that you can find at the bottom of our episode.
There you go, Jack Off.
Yeah, that was my. And I'll show BB my fucking paperwork going here. I had a bunch of shit crossed out, and that's my ball drop on there. All right, BC, what do you got, my friend? You can talk about I Can't, right? Because you have that, right?
I'm familiar with it anyway.
All right.
I was looking for the through the text here.
Here, I'll show you.
No,
Exhibit A.
Yeah, that's all.
And then he switched one to Shadow Man, and
yeah. I was looking for that.
All right.
See, this is why. See, BC, you need a vacation.
I need more beer. Anyways, I can't. I'm still black enough. I mean, how can you go wrong with anything after this album? I mean, maybe one, two. Anyways, yeah, a superb album, I think. And Bob Glow, Crazy off Babylon, great opener track. And between Babylon and Golgotha, I mean, I think. This is falling into the Priest, the Saxon. I'm missing a band somewhere. Maiden. I think W.A.S.P. is getting better as they go.
I agree.
Just saying. Just putting it out there. And going right back through the first album, which you can. This is almost a desert island album, I think. B.A.D. You cannot go wrong with anything off this first album.
There's no skippers on that first album.
No skippers on this first album. I had to buy three of them because I kept wearing out the cassette. Cassette people.
And then they get eaten on. It's a pain in the balls. Cassettes are coming back. Bands are putting out cassettes. No, it's crazy. I will not be buying cassettes.
I
promise.
Can you get a cassette player?
No.
You can't?
No, I'm not. No, I'm out.
No, dude, they make cassette players of it.
They're tough to find. I try because I had some, stuff that I wanted to check out.
The CD player, and I couldn't do it. Died. Then I went back to cassettes and broke out the old cassette thing, put them in, and then that died. I'm like, fuck, everything's dynamic.
I have a dual cassette player.
I used to.
They were nice. Like, the one nice. And then the other one would play, and then you could record from one to the other. Yeah, they were fucking great, man.
Yeah.
They were cool. BB, what do you got?
All right. So.
Go with the songs that you have.
I'm going to say. All right, so song number two on your list is actually song number four, Crazy. Unfortunately, we've said Doug Blair's name so many times. In my notes, I said, what's crazy about the song is a solo from Doug Blair. So it's like beating a dead horse tonight.
It's crazy. It's crazy. He's a live ripping horse.
So across the board, everybody had it.
True. Bad, B-A-D. Another great song from their debut album. You know, it's an iconic hard rock album that didn't get enough credit that it deserved. And Inside the Electric Circus, as BC would say, fantastic song, an iconic.
What the fuck? You did more of a raspberry kind of thing. Ooh, like the Bronx. The Bronx cheer.
He put a lot of lip into it.
He had a little extra spittle on that one.
BC, Inside the Electric Circus.
I bid you welcome to life inside.
give it up, BC.
Thank you. But, yeah, a great pick. I love this. I love this song, and how can you go wrong? Fantastic song.
All right. Awesome. there's our deep cut, you guys. I hope you enjoyed the show. Definitely check them out. We'll go around the table real quick, and we'll give our final goodbyes and wrap it up. What do you got? BB, give it up, buddy.
Thanks. Thanks for having me back. Whew. You know, this was tough.
You're on double secret probation.
This was a double secret probation. But what a great episode to come back on. I love W.A.S.P. I love Blackie's vocals and just a fantastic show. Steve and Michael, once again, thank you for coming on and helping me bust balls to Mr. Wright here. I always like a little sidekick here to. I don't need too much help, but I always need a little
push.
Yeah, a little push. But fantastic. Thanks for having me back. W.A.S.P., get out there, start picking up those albums from 2001 and beyond, because you'll be really pleasantly surprised.
How about Dylan?
Yeah, W.A.S.P., I need to check them out more.
Yes. Dylan is waxing poetic once again.
I usually have a lot of in-depth things to say, but I'm not up on W.A.S.P.
I mean, you could like say, you know, goodbye and hello and whatever.
Thanks for coming on, Steven. Sorry that
everybody's like the codpiece.
Being weird today.
We're going on a plane to go to Vegas in a couple days, so Dylan is hours. He's just upset that he can't take his cod piece that has the fucking saw blade on it. He's just pissed off about that. It's not going to get through security.
He's going to fit right in down there on the Vegas Strip.
Woo! That's right. Hey, so you can get your picture taken with the fucking Teletubbies and fucking Batman and Spider-Man and shit. You can get your picture taken with the fucking Fuck Like a Beast God piece.
Yeah.
you know it'd be cool? They fucking have out in front of Caesar's Palace, they have the big fucking statue of Caesar. It'd be cool if someone put the fucking Fuck Like a Beast God piece on fucking Caesar.
You know what? In front of fucking I gotta go Caesar to work Palace. Tomorrow and 3D print one. You gotta do it.
That'd be fucking awesome. That'd be cool. That'd be good, like if W.A.S.P. ever played the United States again, they play fucking Vegas, they can throw the cod piece on, you know? All right, I'm sorry, I lost. BC.
I summed this up. W.A.S.P. are one of those few bands, to this very day even, I will go out and buy their stuff without even blinking an eye at it.
You hear it's out, you're buying it.
True that. The list is getting smaller nowadays, but they're definitely one of definitely.
True that.
All right, cool. Steven, what do you got for us? Give Growin Up Rock a good plug here. We are huge fans of the show. Fucking absolutely love it. Let our listeners that I hope that our listeners have checked you guys out. And if not, let them know what you guys are all about.
If you've got new listeners, then check out the Growin Up Rock podcast, growinuprock.com. We are a hard rock and heavy metal podcast. We either do themed episodes or interview episodes, and we play kick-ass rock and roll music. So come check us out. We have a good time, have a few laughs. It's all good over there at the Growin Up Rock podcast. But before I go, I have to tell my W.A.S.P. story. I'll be quick.
Oh, okay. So, we were supposed to remind you, but we forgot.
Yeah, Blackie Lawless, that motherfucker owes me $35.
And I'll tell
you why. I only saw W.A.S.P. once, and I saw them, like I said, opening up for Iron Maiden on the Power Slave tour. But then I had the opportunity to see them again more recently in the 2000s, when it was just Blackie on guitar and whoever else was in the band at the time. They played this club here in Atlanta. They came on. And from the get-go, Blackie was bitching and moaning about the monitors. They literally played about maybe a song and a half, two songs, three songs, tops. And that motherfucker kicked over the monitor and walked off stage. They never came back. I was pissed. I wanted my fucking money back. Now, I spent $35 on that damn ticket. Say, wouldn't you be pissed if you spent $35 on a ticket, they played three songs and bitched the whole time and then walked off stage and never came back?
Well, let me tell you, my friend, at least you got to see fucking three songs. BC and I drove a fucking hour and a half to go see W.A.S.P. down in fucking Allentown, Pennsylvania, and then we get there and it's this club, and there's usually everyone that has to have a fucking cigarette or they'll fucking die. It's got to stand out in front of the fucking venue, so you have to walk through a fucking cloud of cigarette smoke to walk in the place.
So BC and I drive an hour and a half. We get there, and there's like two people standing out front. I'm like, this is not fucking good. We walk in. The place is empty, and the guy's like, are you here for the WASP show? We're like, and now as we walk down the street, you can see the fucking tour buses in the alleyway down the street. So we're like, what the fuck? So we walk in. The guy's like, oh, are you here for the WASP show? We're like, yeah. He goes, well, they're not playing tonight. We're like, what? Apparently some bullshit fucking happened with the something bullshit story with the opening band or blah, 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 or something like that. So consider yourself fortunate, Mr. Michael, that you got to see at least fucking three songs. So we didn't even get a chance for him to bitch about the fucking monitors. So I was anti-WASP for the longest fucking time.
Beaver.
I was fucking like, I wanted to, I didn't throw any shit out, but like they were on my fucking blacklist for fucking a long goddamn time. So consider yourself fortunate that you got to see them. And I just want to say, everybody, first and foremost, thank you, Stephen, for spending some time with us. It's always great having you on here. And if you guys have not checked out the Growin Up Rock podcast, go check those guys out. And like we said, in BC's gym here today was one of the bands that I learned from the Growin Up Rock podcast and was able to tell BC about, and he used it for one of his gyms. Fucking Hell's Addiction, great band, fucking rocking band. So check them out. Check out Growin Up Rock podcast. And I think WASP is just a great band. I think there's two versions of it. Like we said, there's the fun WASP and there's like the metal WASP. And right in the middle, you have Hell Dorado in there. There's more of a fun type album. Which WASP do you guys like better? If you know, if you're a classic WASP fan, let us know. If you're like the newer stuff, like let us know, check it out. And I want to say thank you to Blackie Lawless and all the guys he's had in the band over the years. Like there's been a shitload of them, but you know, Chris Holmes, Randy Piper, Bob Kulick, Doug Aldrich, Daryl Roberts, Doug fucking Blair. I salute you guys because you guys fucking totally kicked ass. Blackie Lawless, thank you for all the music, that you cool shit that you gave us over the years. I want to thank everybody out there for listening. If you're new to the show, thank you for tuning in. Check us out. Go back to our back catalog. We have a lot of cool shows, a lot of cool topics. We have a ton of cool shit coming up. Steven, I will be seeing you in a couple days. We are converging on Las Vegas within the next couple days for Mr. Sonny Pooney's birthday party. So by the time you guys hear this episode, we will have already been there. So I'm sure it's going to be a fucking awesome time. So Steven, I hope you and Jen have a safe flight and travels out to Vegas, and we'll see you in a couple days. And thanks once again, my friend.
Woohoo! Had a great time, as always. Happy that our friend BB decided to return to the show. And, yeah, it's been a great time, as always. Love talking to you guys. Love talking rock and roll. And looking forward to hanging out and seeing you in Vegas. Safe travels to everybody.
Thank you. Appreciate it, Steve. And I do want to say one more thing about WASP. I hope that WASP plays a show in the States again that we can go to, that we can take BC to, that Ooh. He will not be fucking roofied at.
That's right.
We can enjoy the show.
And BC won't be better security,
beating everybody up, and BC won't be drugged. If you ever hook up and you meet me, I will tell you the story about BC getting, in quotations, roofied. So you guys out there, have a great week. Thanks for tuning in. Share us with your friends. Reviews would be great on Podchaser, on Apple, on Facebook. Just give us a good review. We'll read it out on the air. Thank you guys for tuning in. Take care of yourselves. Take care of each other. We will see you next time, and there definitely will be the next time. Just, you're going to pause it for a second here, Dylan, because I have my thing. I just have to fucking look at
it. You said you had it ready.
I do have it ready, but I don't have it ready.
So you don't have it ready is what you're saying.
I don't have it ready yet.
I have it picked. But I forgot what the fuck it was, so I wrote it in my notes on my phone. Okay.